Do I have to sit in front of the microphone? That's the idea.
It depends how well people can hear from the back, basically.
Because I can speak well.
Okay, thank you.
Good morning. During this presentation, we will focus on the technological objects that can be identified as digital screens. Typical examples are the screens of laptops, personal computers, smartphones and tablets, by means of which one can connect to the internet and social media. Not just young people and children, the digital natives as they are often referred to, but everybody gives meaning to the world in relation to screens, by integrating them in daily life and by up and downloading different representations of reality by means of these objects. Accordingly, our society consists of screenagers, not just teenagers surrounded by and interacting with screens, but an entire population living in an age of screens. It was the medium of cinema which introduced this technology in society from the end of the 19th century onwards. For Gilles Deleuze, cinema always shows the world, and here lies our interest in his study. Watching cinema is a way of being connected to the world. It shows aspects of the world in the process of being formed or dissolving through the movement of lines and points taken at any distant whatevers of their course. Cinema comes from the Greek word kinetic, which means a motion. As an art form, it has the potential to offer an experience of the world in which thinking does not think anymore through a given method or a presupposed image of thought, which determines our goals and our methods when we try to think. Cinema is a practice of images and signs created by great directors who think through moving images and create compositions of images and signs that is a preverbal, intelligible content. Deleuze conceived cinema as an automaton. What is important is that, in line with Walter Benjamin, for example, he believed that the task at hand is not to tame cinema, but precisely to allow it to be an automaton and to render it spiritual. Deleuze conceptualizes his spiritual automaton as always consisting of two contradicting states of mind which nevertheless coincide. Cinematic movement and time influence the spectator, who is conscious and unconscious, active but also passive, critical, yet at the same time surrendering to the experience. Or as Robert Bresson puts it, cinema allows the spectator not to see what one is already thinking, but to think about what it is one sees. Having introduced cinema from a Deleuzian point of view, we want to focus on the digital screen. Could we speak of an automaton the way Deleuze interpreted cinema, or is there something else that becomes possible? Nowadays, the screen is experienced in a much more complex way. It comes in different shapes and sizes, and it's accompanied by different technologies. Also, the screenager relates to it not only in cinema auditorium, but in broad daylight and everyday spaces as well, both public and private. As Deleuzian media theorist Patricia Pisters argues in her book The Neural Image, we belong to a digital screen culture in which a multiplicity of screens surround us and offers new modes of interacting in and with the world. What kind of experiences are taking place because of this development? Pisters argues that maybe cinema gave the world its screen. This means that the screen is no longer only part of cinema, where one more or less consciously goes to buy a ticket and experience moving pictures. Gradually, screen technology seems to have reversed this movement of going into a specific, designated public space to experience a screen. It's not that the screenager doesn't visit the cinema screen anymore, rather technology also brought the screen to her. The television screen, for example, entered living rooms, hotel rooms, cafes and other spaces. Electronic billboards inhabited streets and nowadays compete with touchscreens, which are present in railway stations, airports and shopping malls. Also from the 1980s onwards, computer monitors started dominating desks at work, at home and in schools. What is more, today, laptops and tablet PCs pop up naturally from backpacks when a university lecture is about to begin. And the latest developments allow watches and glasses to become screens, or that screens inhabit our pockets. This shows that this technological object has not only reached the living environment and many public spaces, but also the very physical position of the individual. With the smartphone, the screen is literally at fingertips. With the smartwatch, the screen is around the wrist, in the case of Google Glasses, for example, part of the daily point of view. What we want to emphasize is a general shift in the experience of screens. Namely, now I quote Patricia Pisters, the shift from considering the spectator in front of a spectacle screen to a spectator embedded or immersed in an audiovisual environment in which filmmaker and camera, characters and spectators, world and screens are all circling and questioning each other, and in which we have to ask ourselves constantly, where is the screen? How do I relate to it? What does it make me see, feel, grasp, do? End quote. So in relation to cinema, Deleuze asked the question how to render the automaton spiritual. The question we ask now is how we make the digital automaton spiritual. What we explore is how we can have attention for and be aware of what the screen makes us do. And maybe this is a question education needs to give an answer to. In Taking Care of Youth and Generations, the French philosopher Bernard Stiegler, for example, argues that the digitization of society requires a response from education. Discussing a project in art education which experiments with digital technology, we try to make this concrete.
Now I will present a research project we've done, and the project is a kind of interview between artists, information scientists, designers, pedagogues, researchers, art students and lecturers of the art studios, mixed media and photography. The starting point of the project is that today we are confronted with an increasing interest for screen learning. So our question is, how can we relate ourselves to that screen learning, and how can we make a digital course in arts? Online learning have made it possible. Online learning have made it possible to divide learning from a particular time and space, a location or an institution, and to suit it with more individual needs by permanent monitoring and profiling, for instance. In such a more efficient and in a much more efficient and effective way than primitive school technologies could do. Now, instead of using the internet as a technology to transform the classroom into a learning environment of available resources for fast, efficient and effective learning, in an environment without noise or disturbance in terms of classroom concentration problems, with our project we want to explore whether and how it is possible to make use of internet in a way that it generates attention instead of catching our attention, which implies a form of slowing time. So in contrast to an approach of education in terms of individual learning trajectories, we want to explore how it is possible to think about an online course as a technology that has a particular materiality and form, and which is operative in itself. What we just want to do is experimenting with changes in education in the sense that we want to experience internet as a technology that makes a particular way of doing possible and impossible. This is part of a way of thinking of art education in terms not only as a practice in which particular artistic skills and competences have to be acquired, but also as a collective practice that allows inhabiting the matter at hand. This calls for an experimental attitude for trying out with the materiality. So trying out with the technology and the techniques of the screen and the web. So our first, we did some experiments. So our first experiment was an experiment in which we played the World Wide Web in order to experience what the internet makes us do. From this point of view, we instructed students of the visual art studios to go, art studios and mixed media, to make an individual trip to a place in the world, which would last at least 1 week. Furthermore, we asked them to communicate at least once a day their artistic experience. For this purpose, we used an existing platform called Padlet. We preferred Padlet over email or Facebook because of its particular configuration. That is, it is like a simple blackboard, without facilitating structure or hierarchy. The idea was that everyone could contribute and could give instructions to each other. We were therefore inspired by Hans Ulrich Obrist, his project Do It at Influx, in which artists also gave online instructions. Accordingly, and also as a consequence of the material conditions produced by Padlet, there was no set of good instructions that defined beforehand how to interact with this digital platform. Rather, the set of good instructions actually was also an important part of the experiment and research project, as something that should be addressed while experiencing the digital space itself. So as students start posting their artistic experience, it was fascinating to see that the white wall functions as a tryout for everyone. Nobody knew what would happen next. We all had particular expectations, as well as a student, as a teacher, or as a researcher. We saw that the student posted pictures, films, statements. It could be argued that they posted pictures and images that have nothing to do with the place they physically were situated. It was as if different kinds of associations were made at a particular moment, often without really thinking it through. So the pedagogue, I'm a pedagogue, involved in the project, was confused. What does that all have to do with the place the students physically are residing, was my question. What about experiencing a place? As a real teacher, I thought it was necessary to intervene. As a reaction and an attempt to remember the commitment, I posted the following instruction. Focus lies on the artistic experience of a place. How do I relate myself as an artist to that place? I did not feel, however, that my intervention had some effect. So I posted a second intervention. I thought about recalling Jan Maskelyne's paper he presented at the symposium just before the experiment, where he said something about attention and concentration. And he said, attention and concentration not only in the sense of being focused, also in the sense of taking care. And I quote his quote, for me, taking care for and being attentive are translations of faire attention in the sense of fabricating attention, so to speak. This is not only a matter of focus and concentration, of the ability to notice something, but it also entails a loving concern, dedication and showing respect, and of course, being there, being present, end quote. So I recorded the act of typing these words and sentences, and I uploaded this recording onto the Padlet, that's the platform. I thought that perhaps the act of reading every word in itself would have an effect of slowing down, which would make the students attentive and interested for that which would happen to them in the very space they were in. Another thing I did was writing some concrete instructions borrowed from a text of Tommaso Venturini, which asked to pay attention for circles and squares, to read the city and the place in this way, and perhaps to make something visible in another way. Some people reacted on these instructions, Some indeed made pictures of squares and circles. There was a student who made pictures of an airport. Some made also pictures of triangles. For me, in any case, it was clear that the role of the teacher as the one who gives its authority to the instructions became inoperative. It was only possible to post instructions or images that could generate a reaction. A relation of authority between the teacher and the student became obsolete. Everyone, students as well as teachers or lecturers, were addressed as producers of posts and were equal in that sense. In a group discussion with the lecturers and students a week after the first experiment, the students reflected on the first experiment in the following way. We lacked feedback, they said, from our teachers who did not comment on our posts. We did not know if what we did was appreciated. Some of us deleted existing posts, which puzzled and frustrated others because they did not know why these posts were deleted. As a response to this, the teachers asked why they did not simply repost what was deleted. One student said she thought about doing this, but perhaps, so she said, it was not that good to post it again. Other reactions were related to technical problems. More in general, some students seemed to hint that they did not see the meaning of the project anymore. Someone made the remark that what we did, perhaps, was what internet did to education. The backlit did not allow the student to make art. In a matter of fact, something else happened. Perhaps we made a kind of collective sketchbook. A sketchbook is a typical tool of an artist. It is a notebook which often consists of traces and first steps, doodles and so on. The problem, however, was that the Padlet as a sketchbook no longer triggered the student, since it became impossible to read what is produced. It was not possible to see anything anymore. What the Padlet created was a kind of chaos. It was as if the way in which the images were gathered detached them from their regular meaning and use, which in a sense meant that they were profaned and as such open for another use. The chaos Padlet produced was not experienced as a failure of the project, however, but as an opening, an opportunity to experience oneself as a curator, someone who creates meaning. It was as if the first experiment reset our preconceived thoughts with which the project started. So we asked the students to make the Padlet readable again by saying something about the images and to use a logic between the images for which no clear rules of usage is already available. We asked our students to make an audio or video guide that could navigate us while visiting the digital world, to produce something which would allow us to see and to think about what is there to be seen. Some students made a few proposals. It was the starting point for slowing down the conversation and to think about what there is. And I quote Bresson, to arrive at a point where you think about what you see instead of seeing about what you already think. They equally start to point to the Padlet and more especially to different images in it. This pointing made us look again at the Padlet. The Padlet was transformed from an abstract set of images into a common space that can be pointed at, referred to and spoke about. Through pointing, they made reference to something that is not visible anymore. They made the images present again and turned them into common reference space as well. So the question is how internet structure, the system through which data flows at high speed, the automaton, can be influenced by artistic or pedagogical elements. That is, can we develop an online course that does not facilitate the production of learning outcomes and hyperactivity, but that generates interest in the sense of taking